Good morning. Welcome back. Today is Thursday, again, October 7, Class 18, reading the bio of Nisargadatta Maharaj, as well as his teachings. We've moved through the David Godman reminiscences. We're in the middle of the biography from G.K. Damodara Rao, Mr. Rao. Spelled R-O-W like Roe, but actually I think it's pronounced, it's commonly spelled R-A-U, Rao, and that may well be a Maharashtrian family name. Moving through his biography, almost finished, last time we ended with the arrival of Maurice Friedman, whom Nisargadatta said was a Jnani, and very, very advanced soul. In the time when the only Westerners in India were the most serious, and that was the case also in Thailand and Burma and Sri Lanka, in the 60s and 70s and before, starting in the 80s, pretty much late 70s, 80s, 90s, so on, air travel became more available. And the spread of books like Tattvamasi, I Am That, or I Is Such, grew the spread of the of Advaita Vedanta books, teachers, philosophy in the West, Zen and Theravada Buddhism eventually. Tibetan Buddhism grew also in the West, and then you have more, spiritual tourism, or guru hopping, or seekers of gurus, of being Western students coming. And David Godman was sort of in one of the earlier waves, where Maurice Friedman was in one of the primary waves, much before David Godman, and was a pretty attained being. This time we're continuing the bio, and almost towards the end, the further sections are only three. Miracles of Maharaj, then the last days, then the last moments, and then we go back to the wisdom quotations where we're at number 70, and that goes to 200, and that's where we'll go, probably starting next week, because I think we'll possibly be able to close or complete the bio reading today. So, Miracles of Maharaj from Damodara Rao. So let's read, or I will read, and I hope you enjoy. On Maharaj's birthday, so let me just say before, again, he was born in 1897, so-called, born a full moon day in March 1987, so he was probably in Aries, possibly. 1897 till, when did he die? It's interesting, 1981, right in the middle of, right in the middle of the raw material, and right in the middle of my own September 1981, yeah, right in the middle of my own intensive meditative process in college and then in the monasteries. So the early 80s, 80 to 85, was kind of interesting time for my sector. Okay, Miracles of Maharaj. On Maharaj's birthday, one of his devotees requested Maharaj, or Nisargadatta, to permit him to publish a souvenir, as it would give him adequate publicity. Nisargadatta sharply rebuked him and said, "I'm only seeing the reality as others do and pointing out the obvious truth, sat. What is the use of publicity?" Pointing to the picture of his guru and others in the ashram, he said, quote, "If all this is responsible for bringing publicity to me, I'd rather pay 100 rupees to somebody to take away all these photos from here and drown in the deep sea." And I think, I'm not sure why he's saying that. Maybe he was getting tired of so many people thronging him. And so the biographer Rao continues, though Maharaj was not known for miracles and was usually very shy even to talk about them, many miracles have been reported. So I don't see how there's any miracle going on there. He goes on, I would mention only a few of them as they find a place in the sheaf of papers given to me to make this biography. Maharaj's niece was almost dying, and her doctors had given up hope and told the relatives that it was just a matter of an hour. The life of the girl was slowly ebbing away, and her husband and relatives and friends were anxiously waiting outside the house, thinking about the preparations to be made for her funeral. Maharaj, who normally used to visit their house, had gone there on a courtesy call. When he heard that she was dying, he entered the room where her body lay and said loudly, "What is this? Why are you sleeping at this hour? Get up. Your mama has come," meaning himself, "after a long time. Will you not give him a cup of tea?" Like, I'm your mama. Your mama, your mother has come, meaning me, "after a long time. Will you not give him, your mother, meaning me, a cup of tea?" Hearing his voice, she got up from the bed, much to the amazement of her husband and others surrounding her, and made tea for Maharaj, who enjoyed it. Only then the relatives told Maharaj about her serious condition and how Maharaj had saved her life. And that was it. So she was on her deathbed. He comes over to see her, basically transmits energy or something, or talks to her soul, and she gets up, makes him tea, and she's just fine. Going on, a lady disciple had gone to the ashram after a long absence. She was somewhat nervous as to what Maharaj would think of her. Adding to her embarrassment and shock, Maharaj asked her, "Why have you come here now? Go back immediately. Don't stay even for a minute." That's very rough if you hear that from your guru or someone you love or want. On hearing this, the lady left very miserable and unhappy, and she rightly thought that the guru was angry with her. She did not understand the ways of a saint. With tears in her eyes, she prostrated before Maharaj, who was unmoved, and she went back home. She found that her husband had suddenly taken seriously ill, and that her presence was urgently required, as he had to be taken to the hospital for treatment. It was then that she realized the strange behavior of Maharaj, which had a divine purpose. So, it's an interesting thing that, so he was very rough and harsh to her, so that she would immediately go back to her husband and do what indeed she was needed for her to do, which had required her to be there, immediately. Why didn't Maharaj or Nisargadatta just tell her, "Your husband's very sick, you need to go back there immediately"? I don't know. But there was a case, actually, where some people wanted to come to Nityananda, and he did something similar to this. I don't know. I mean, there are probably many cases. I remember, which I may be not right, that he just told them they have to go back and wasn't rough with them. Now, you know, we just don't know. We just don't know. What looks like him, Nisargadatta, being unnecessarily rough, where he could have just said, "Your husband's deathly ill, I'm sorry," she would have been in fear rather than discouragement. She would have been terrified of her husband dying if Nisargadatta had told her the truth, rather than be upset and saddened. Now, maybe she had certain pride in mind that he was addressing. And nobody would know it, not even her, perhaps. But he would know it, or he knew it. If it's there, we can presume he probably knew it, or did know it. I don't know. You know, we don't know the mind of those above us. We can't see the head of those taller than ourselves. And so we can't see his scalp. I cannot see the scalp of those taller than I. So, presumably, you know, assuming he knows what he's doing, which is a pretty useful assumption, treating her harshly was better than treating her honestly or explaining thoroughly. in this case. And so there are all sorts of things that gurus see that we can't imagine, that we don't know, and we won't know. We can speculate. And then there are fake gurus, too. I don't think he's a fake guru at all. But there are fake gurus who use that kind of inscrutability and then make public recourse to inscrutability or superiority. You can't know where I'm coming from. Just shut up and take it, a fake guru would say. Not Nisargadatta, but he does what he does, and we don't really know. Just the same as Nityananda and many gurus, they do what they do. So, but he knew she needed to be back there, and by his action, she got back as soon as possible. Going on, another instance is that of a disciple who was admitted into the hospital for some very serious illness. Maharaj was informed about it, and he was very fond of that disciple for his purity of heart. He completed the bhajan at the home, and then left for the hospital to see the disciple. In a place like Bombay, where the hospitals are scattered at distant places, it was not easy to reach within time. Maharaj, a simple man, would not take a taxi. Instead, he waited for the bus and got into it. It is well known in Bombay that there are long queues for the buses and one has to take his turn. Though Maharaj was informed that the disciple was dead, he was not perturbed. He reached the hospital after some delay, went straight to the mortuary where the body was wrapped up in a cloth and was waiting to be removed by the relatives. On seeing the body, Maharaj said, "How can you go away without my permission?" He then removed the cloth covering the body, put his hand on his chest, and called the disciple by name and asked him to get up. The disciple came back to life. So raising the dead? Totally doable with a true guru who's really, you know, finished with higher self. You know, that's the point. I mean, I might have some sense of what jnana is, but to talk about eighth density, I don't know. And so he must have seen, if the story is true, which it certainly could be, he knew that the body had not decomposed sufficiently. He might have helped to make sure that the body decomposed slowly or had its decomposition arrested on the way. Who knows what he can do, right? He could have spoken to the soul the person could have been still in their astral body and not having broken a cord. You know, the cord between what? The higher self and the physical and astral sheaths. He could have seen that. He could have spoken to the soul. He could have known that it was karmically acceptable. And he could have indeed done energy transfer that called the soul back or made a deal, made an agreement with the higher self aspect of that person. And it was known that that was acceptable, and he did that work to bring the one back because it could, you know, the body was still viable and it was karmically permissible. And so there you go. So, you know, people who think that only Jesus could raise the dead or other than that, he must be a demon. This is so stupid, you know, but I guess we don't have to worry about that. But they have no idea how small-minded they are thinking only our teacher can do this and anybody else must be a demon or couldn't do it. Nobody can do it but our teacher, or anybody but our teacher who does it really is a demon. I mean, you know, the universe is a bigger place than that, and conduct and attainment is greater than belief and doctrine, meaning what a person believes is really secondary to what they have become metaphysically, or their seven chakra development, which is associated with conduct, meaning virtue. So, highly virtuous non-Christians go to hell, while quite selfish, aggressive, harmful, harming Christians of any group, or Muslims, or, you know, Jews, or whatever, of any group, that has the doctrine and belief and pledged in accord with their view of their group or their sect that only they will go to heaven, that person goes to heaven with the so-called correct doctrine, while the one whose virtue is magnificent goes to hell or purgatory? Really? So some people can't get that. That just shows, you know, this really is a ball of confusion. And it's, you know, God is a universal, not a cultic, not a sectarian. The creator of light is universal, absolute. Thus is the path. Thus is the path from the human back to the absolute, or from the human to the absolute, to God, to, you know, the ultimate, to source. Source is the absolute is source. The path to source must be universal, must be a universal path. And therefore, it's associated with conduct, not belief. Conduct is universal. Anyone with any belief or no belief, confused belief or so-called right belief, sophisticated belief or crude belief, is still capable of conduct. Conduct is universal. Belief is sectarian. Belief is cultic, of a cult or a culture or a particular. But conduct is universal. Any level of any degree of belief, any degree of sophistication of belief, any degree of intelligence, wisdom, or contradictory, illogicality, irrationality of belief is unimportant. What is critical is conduct, at least at this stage. You know, at higher levels, view is necessary. But at this point in third density, certainly, it's right conduct, right speech, right action, right livelihood, as Buddhists would say. It's the ethical question. It's the question of ethics and virtue and morality. That's the absolute that gets souls into the light and to a much higher level of proximity to source and the absolute, to return to the absolute. And so, yeah, it looks like old Nisargadatta raised the dead. How about that? So it can be done by one such as he. Going on, another instance reported is when Maharaj was walking through the streets of Pune along with his disciples. He suddenly, where Osho ended up eventually, he suddenly stooped in front of a bank and asked one of his disciples whether he'd like to be employed in the said bank. The disciple, a young man, who was badly in need of a job, was overjoyed at the compassion of Maharaj. With great humility, he touched Maharaj's feet and said, "As per your will, Maharaj." Maharaj and the disciples walked along, giving no thought, and the young disciple did not in the least dream that he would get a job in the bank, as nothing was known for a month. But, surprisingly later, he got a letter from the bank appointing him in a clerical post. He could scarcely believe it, and jumping with joy, he went straight to Bombay, prostrated before Maharaj, and conveyed the happy news. So, he was able to know what the disciple needed, whether he was told or not. He was able to work, you know, presuming all this is true, which is totally possible, or likely, communicate with the representative of the bank who'd be writing the letter, telepathically. And, I mean, he could have known that there would be a position available in the bank in a month. He could have known that there was a position available and who to telepathically communicate to facilitate the writing of the letter to him, to this young man disciple. So he facilitated that. So that is indeed, you know, that the case of somebody who's really finished with the octave, they do have cities. There's somebody who's really living higher self fully, they do have cities. They have magical powers, yes. Yet another instance is that, but there are people with cities who are not at the level of higher self, of course. Yet another instance is that of a 20-year-old girl who suffered from tuberculosis. Her operation was fixed at Bombay. Apprehensive that she may not live, she went to Maharaj for darshan, meeting, attendance with him. prostrated before him along with her father, who had accompanied her. But in an ununderstandable way, Maharaj said, "Go immediately to Nasik. No operation is necessary. If perhaps your father has fixed it," meaning set it or you know, arranged it, "have it canceled. It will be of some importance to note that Nasik is a great pilgrim center, and the famous temple of Triambak is situated there in Nasik. It is said that Sri Rama cut the nose of Surpanaka when he was staying in Panchavati." Pancha is five. Panchavati. And the word Nasik, or nose, reflected this incident, and the place came to be known by the name Nose. Maharaj evidently had a purpose in asking her to go and stay in Nasik, leaving Bombay, and it is needless to state that she got cured. So again, he's working all sorts of understandings that he's not sharing. Many disciples had other wonderful experiences, but Maharaj used to advise them not to publicize the miracles. He used to say very cryptically, "Don't come here as you would go to a shop or a bazaar. Do as I tell you. Give yourself up completely to the guru inside, and your problems will disappear." The guru inside. He didn't say, "Give yourself up completely to me." He said, "Give yourself up completely to the guru inside, the inner guru," which is higher self, or God. Higher self is a logos, as God. The inner God, the real one, the one inwardly. And then your problems will disappear. So give yourself up completely to the inner guru, and problems disappear. This is a very perfect teaching. Such was Maharaj, the great Yani, a simple, unassuming person, repository of vast knowledge, living in a crowded lane in Ketwadi area, in a humble abode. From his dress and appearance, nobody would say that he was a spiritual dynamo. He had bright, powerful eyes, and to draw a parallel, one is reminded of Bhagawan Ramana. Ramana Maharshi, I guess. Maharaj spoke only in homely Marathi, though he knew English. He spoke it with perfect ease and composure. Though the truths he presented were all high dynamite, this guy likes to be dramatic, he shunned publicity and formed no organization and did not accept gifts. He worked alone. It will be of some importance to note that he refused to be treated as a guru. To quote a review in The Hindu, some magazine or journal, on Maharaj, "With an impish glint in his bright eyes and with a sweeping wave of his expansive hand, he would say, quote, 'When I go about, I'm just an old man out for a walk, so nobody bothers me, and I can go as I pleased. As I please.'" So, I respect that a lot. "When I go out, I'm just an old man out for a walk, so nobody bothers me, and I can go as I please." This sometimes comes after a lifetime or several lifetimes of having given oneself massively to selfless service or service, you know, the needs of others and community. Like Nityananda being thronged 24/7 nearly, allowing himself to be thronged by thousands and thousands of people wanting something. That looks awful to me. And Nisargadatta didn't want that at all. But I'm sure Nisargadatta had done something like that before. And I'm sure Nityananda is doing it because that was simply, you know, part of his life purpose to make that demonstration. Or part of the cost of the payment for such a high soul having the opportunity to be here in this dimension. Once upon a time, somebody told me that some Tibetan lamas had the view, or some people had the view of Tibetan lamas, and I'm sure any true teacher, you know, not all Tibetan lamas are true teachers, obviously, but many of them are, for the opportunity of incarnation, the cost is having disciples. So, for the opportunity of having a body, the cost is allowing disciples to you know, continually request from that one, something like that. Going on, the purpose of life, as Maharaj points out, is to be free from suffering, just like Gautama's teaching. And all suffering results from our deep-rooted identification with the body-mind complex. Boom. I'm tempted, which is the basis of lower triad blockage, of course. I'm tempted to quote some more words of Maharaj which express his simple philosophy. Quote, only the self is, now whether that's aham or atman, only aham or only atman is. It is impersonal, pure awareness beyond time and space. Unattached to anything, it is ineffable bliss, ananda. Desire is the villain of the peace, meaning desire is the enemy of peace. And so, the purpose of life to be free from suffering requires working with desire, because it is desire that leads to or associates with body-mind identification. So lower triad blockage equals distortions in mind and energy blockages and energy, you know, distortions or problems, issues with energy flow from rib to crown. Lower triad blockage equals distortions in mind, equals desires associated with mind-body identification. Buddhism would say grasping, aversion, and ignorance, the three unwholesome roots or poisons, ashravas, kleshas, distorted mental flow, vasanas, inclinations, tendencies that lead to that are associated with mind-body identification and lead to further blockage, thus continuing that mind-body identification. Meanwhile, spiritual bypass is not a good idea, and thus a sort of distorted disidentification is not recommended. That's spiritual bypassing, meaning I'm not this body, I don't have a feeling, I don't care, I'm okay, I don't have distortion, all is one. It's not real anyway. People talk about that and try to trick themselves out of the fact that they're in pain because they really do continue to hold distorted beliefs and desires associated with mind-body identification. Fine. Just admit it. Be honest. Be real. And so, desire is the villain of peace or the enemy of peace. And so you see, all of this comes down to translation, right? Desire is the enemy of peace. Meanwhile, there's the desire to be free, which is not an enemy of peace. The desire to be free of suffering. The desire to be free of desire. The desire to be free of distorted desire. Or the desire to only want freedom. I know I want things that lead to enslavement or let's just say bondage or entrapment. I have some desires that lead to further attachment or further dukkha, and I desire to be free of those desires. That's a worthy desire. There's got to be, you know, desire for freedom to move out of bondage and to move out of lower desires or desires that lead to further bonding. So there's desire that leads to greater dukkha. There's desire that leads to greater sukha. And sukha is like moksha. At the end, the final sukha is moksha. The final happiness is liberation, freedom. But his teaching about, you know, only the self is impersonal, pure awareness beyond time and space. Sounds like higher self. And that's the first attainment, I would think. Going on, fueled by the memory of the dead past and dreaming for a rosy future. We do not live in the intense present, which is the only sat reality. This is the talk of the translator Rao, or the compiler puts his own view in, like I do. Abide not in the future. This is not Nisargadatta's quote. Abide not in the future, but the simple I am, and give up thinking I am this or I am that. That's what identification in mind body is. I am this and I'm that. I'm angry. I'm Scott. I'm great, I'm terrible. That's the identification. But if you abide in I am, it's not continuing to repeat I am, I am, I am. So be careful of students who think they know. Be careful of me. If anything I say sounds off, you know, don't eat it. Put it off to the side. End quote. Here's a quote from Nisargadatta. Love and do what you will, right? I think St. Paul said that. And when all the false self-identifications are thrown away, what remains is all-embracing love. You're no longer separate from the world. You are not in the world, but the world is in you, exactly as Nityananda said. Maharaja's sayings were priceless pearls. Another here, quote, liberation is never of the person. It is always from the person. Discard every self-seeking motive. Do not search for truth. Do not search, for truth will find you. So, source is what I is. Being, you know, that's why Shiva is the god of yogis, because the path is not of adding, it's of subtracting or removing, dissolving all the false, all the unnecessary, all the dukkha, all the binding, all that binds, all that's distorted, all that's unnecessary, all that's unhelpful, all that makes more dukkha, all that is released on the path. But one must be, you know, rigorously honest, as Ra would say. So discard every self-seeking motive. Do not search, for truth will find you, or truth is inside. Such were the teachings of the great Saint Nisargadatta Maharaj, who lived in a crowded lane in Bombay, in a humble abode, wearing the dress of a common man. It's difficult to make him out in a crowd unless you've already known him. He was fond of his grandchildren, who called him Bapa, or God in Marathi, and they used to scramble for a place in his lap. They used to tease him by snatching the cigarette lighter or sometimes spilling the water kept for him while he was in a serious discussion with Maurice Friedman, the Polish engineer. So Maurice Friedman was Polish. I didn't know that. And an engineer. And so you can see the engineering training is excellent for mental development. And so it's not unusual that the guys who have attainment are well-trained mentally. They think through the various doctrines and views. That's important. A strong mind is important to move towards freedom, for sure. On his birthdays and other festive days, he faithfully used to go to the samadhi or tomb of his guru, situated as at Banganga burial ground in Bombay, to offer prayers. One could easily find him traveling in a bus along with others. He didn't want to separate himself, you see. He didn't want to he didn't want people to follow him around. So he didn't wear a robe and cut the figure of a guru, meaning assume the garb and the manner of a holy man. Meanwhile, he didn't avoid people at all. So it's very interesting. He lived burrowed in to Bombay, you know, ghetto or slum or normal neighborhood, lower middle class or lower class, I don't know, economically. So he burrowed himself in to a most urban, populous, high density mega city in India. But he didn't call attention to himself at all. He stayed in the house where he had been for years. He kept the business that he had been doing for years. He kept family, or he was married until his wife died. And he went on buses, he didn't take taxis. He wanted to stay with the people, but he didn't want to call attention to himself or have people follow him. And in fact, he probably resented it a bit. Meanwhile, he also liked it, you know? So he could have shut his house and been, you know, in solitude, but he didn't. So even though he was ornery, actually he was really super loving, because that's a sacrifice, you know? You think that he's doing that for getting something, to get something from the people who came in? He didn't accept gifts. So he didn't accept gifts. He let people come abuse him, almost. He didn't really quite let that, but I mean, he let them use him. meaning they all wanted to talk and gimme, gimme. That's what they're all coming there. People associate for a motive. Kagasana Sutta, a rhinoceros, said Gautama. Yeah, people associate for a motive, and people go to a guru for motives, and sometimes they're beautiful-hearted, and sometimes they're super selfish, and sometimes they're just playing in a game, or they're idiots. And most of them are sincere, though. And he didn't reject them, but he didn't want to accumulate them, so they get sent on their way regularly. He didn't separate himself out from the urban, super high-density situation. He took buses. He went to the public toilet. Meanwhile, he didn't want to call attention to himself. So it's very interesting. I mean, it's a very, very carefully established lifestyle. It's said that Maharaj would not forget to vote and exercise his franchise as a voter in the elections. As is well known, one has got to stand in a queue. Maharaj untiringly, sometimes even in the hot sun, would wait in the queue for long hours and exercise his franchise to vote. The simplicity of his nature baffles all analysis. Maybe. Oftentimes, when he needed a haircut, he would quietly go to a hair-cutting salon, either for a shave or a haircut, without any discomfiture, meaning discomfort. It was an interesting sight to see Maharaj taking his grandchildren along with him and buying them a lassi, milk lassi, in a wayward shop or a wayside shop and teach them how to drink it properly. I'm not sure of the proper lassi drinking. Maharaj loved some of his disciples very dearly, indeed. And even in pouring rain, he would walk with them to Chaupati seashore and discuss with them about the easy path to self-realization. Unmindful of the great stature he occupied as a yani, he would sit on the benches on the seashore in the pouring rain, holding an umbrella and enjoying his bidis. The talk will go on until 11:30 p.m. sometimes, till late in the night. They will be only on atmic matters, meaning the nature of self, and I'd say path, and the few chosen disciples who accompanied him there to hear him, would get their doubts cleared. Sometimes on the wayside, at the pressing request of his disciples, he would enjoy a cup of tea with them. He would walk to the nearby Irani Hotel, so common in Bombay, enjoy a cup of tea there, and also eat a few biscuits. So he was definitely gave himself to his disciples and the city, you know. When Mercedes and Contessa cars were ready to take him wherever he wanted, his grim determination not to accept such obligation, but to, quote, walk along in communion with the self is somewhat astonishing, said Mr. Rao. One has also got to remember that he was over 80 years old then, and not in good health. The dreaded cancer was showing its hood, but he would not go to a doctor. Even the disciples could not understand him and found it difficult to change his iron will. It's interesting, you know, sometimes that happens. The disciple goes against the teacher because he wants the teacher to go to a doctor or live longer. I don't know why they don't just, you know, fully submit and say, yes, I love you, and you are my guru, and I respect whatever you decide. I mean, you're above me. What the hell am I? I just, you know, I'm not going to argue or try to convince you, change your will. That's strange. Anyway, it's of very importance, he wrote, to note that despite the cancer for which he was not taking any treatment, he was cheerful and went through his usual rounds, selling bidis in the shop for an hour, morning bhajan in the loft room, meditation with the disciples without any indication of the deterioration in his physical health. His simple abode, more particularly the loft room, was so peaceful and quiet despite the noise from the street traffic outside. One did not know in what period in human history Maharaj lived. It is said that his affection for his family did not dry up, and his grandchildren clambered up the stairs into the loft room and, crawling along, used to sit on his lap and sometimes divert his attention from the serious talk in which he was engaged. he would call his daughter-in-law and ask her to come and take the children away. So it's his son's wife's children. Maharaj was not a learned man, but he talked in homely Marathi. It's the same, almost the same paragraph as before. Maharaj was not a learned man, but he talked in homely Marathi without quoting scriptures. Though his disciples were anxious to build an ashram, he would not permit it and stoutly opposed it. Smart. He was easily accessible to everyone, rich or poor, provided they showed a spirit of inquiry in his teachings. Doctors who were brought by some of the disciples were baffled, as Maharaj did not show any signs of suffering or pain, especially in the region of the throat. He explained away the absence of suffering by saying, quote, "All this happens in consciousness. I do not feel any pain," end quote. Meaning, it's not in the body, it's in the mind. Or the body is in the mind. You know, the world is in the self, the body is in the mind. And in fact, the body-mind is in the spirit. And so, body-mind-spirit is in the self, actually. So, you can say all this happens in consciousness, the consciousness not as vijnana, a consciousness here as awareness, or satchit. So, mind-body-spirit happens in Atman, and mind-body-spirit and Atman and the seven-dimensional, selfhood identity happens in Paramatman. And so the personal self happens in the absolute, or light happens in its source. Light dances. You are not dancing thoughts. You're not living in a material universe. You're dancing thoughts. So light happens in Satchit, or soul evolution and cosmic plan happens in intelligent infinity. And so if he's living in intelligent infinity or unbound awareness, Paramatman, Satchit, then body happens there too for him. I mean, if he's that high, then he can turn it off. I do not feel any pain. And Nityananda had said something like the yoni or he could feel the pain but chooses not to, you know, engage with it. And so I think that's actually the same, meaning Maharaj or Nisargadatta didn't feel pain because he chose not to, because he was living, you know, the pain or body was happening in unbound awareness beyond personal identification, and he chose not to feel it. And Nityananda is saying the yoni or he could feel the pain, but he chose to, you know, not be there with it, is the same. The pain exists, but it doesn't have to be felt. Just like Nityananda's burning arm. So that's a very high soul, clearly. He goes on, but one could see that as the last days were nearing, Maharaj was showing signs of weakness, even though his face did not lose its radiance and his eyes particularly sparkled. The disciples were anxiously hovering around his bed, but he used to ask them to go back later or come back here later. The disciples knew very well that they would not see him again and were unwilling to leave him, but with a show of his hand he asked them to leave, saying that he was feeling sleepy. Maharaj told his disciples that they need not be worried, that he was not going anywhere, and that he would be with them right through the passing out of body. The disciples reluctantly went home, knowing that a dream was about to end. That's a nice way of putting it. The next chapter, next section, is called The Last Days. Edith Powell, who has compiled the final teachings of Maharaj in her beautiful book, quote, The Nectar of the Lord's Feet, says with great authority, quote, from Edith Powell, the message which comes through loud and clear from Nisargadatta Maharaj's final teachings is to turn to what you were before your so-called birth, before the so-called birth or the emergence of a particular body you've identified yourself with so willingly and unthinkingly. Terrible translation. The message which comes through loud and clear from Nisargadatta's final teachings is to turn to what you were before your so-called birth, which was the emergence of a particular body which you have now identified yourself with so willingly and unthinkingly. So turn to what you were, the mind before birth. He advises, Edith Powell, be in that eternity. You see, everybody got very flowery. They like to be flowery. Be in that eternity, which is a stage of wholeness, even though your body may be broken up, even though you may have no earthly possessions, even though the world around you may go up in flames. Be in that eternity, which is a stage of wholeness, she said, or he said. Yeah, I mean, that's the mind, you know, when they say hold to the I am, it's not repeating the thought I am. It's basically, as far as I can understand what they're talking about, it's the mind of equanimity. It's non-proliferation. It's freedom from incessant samskara production of thought, feeling, and perception, and mental, emotional, nama-rupa, you know, name and form. A quiet mind, silence of mind in a steady state, as Ra said. But there's something more to it than a quiet mind or this dwelling. Because it's not, you know, who, there's no solid self dwelling some fixed place. It's not like there's an I to dwell in a place. That's the point. So even if one knows the practice of I am does not mean continually repeating the thought, I am, I am, I am, I am. No, obviously not. That's attachment to this apparent witness position, which is just continued, you know, proliferation of a empty samskara called I am, I am, I am, I am. No, obviously not that. And silence of mind at a steady state is not I am now in silence of mind at a steady state. Not that either. Silence of mind at a steady state doesn't include the thinking I am in silent mind in a steady state. It's a freedom from that I am itself. The freedom from the production of any thought. I mean, it doesn't mean thoughts don't come, but non-grasping, they come, they go. And the one that sees, knows, I is not this thought, and I is not the field of mind, and I is the one that produces all of these names and perceives all the forms. It's sort of dwelling in emptiness, but there's no solid one to be dwelling. That's the point. And that's why at some level one cannot make, that effort must stop and go to surrender, you know, because there's no substantial selfhood to free. There's no substantial selfhood to be freed. There's only the dream of substantial selfhood that very tangibly feels bound and dukkha. There's quite visceral dukkha. But there isn't a substantial, eternal selfhood that needs to be freed. So if there's still the view, I am a self that needs to be freed, you know, one just keeps repeating such belief or thought in mind, and that's not free. So at a certain level, one has to surrender. And that's why Gautama didn't deal with this talk of self and liberation. He just dealt with... do your practice. Anapanasati will take you all the way. And don't worry about view. Once you get some relative foundational right view, don't worry about view. And lots of the critical matters are atinteya, meaning imponderable or unconstructible, and incomprehensible. When you get there, you'll know. Mindfulness, like Anapanasati, any kind of true sati mindfulness practice, will take you where you will take you all the way. Will take one all the way back. Will take you back to one. Or take you, who think you are a substantial identity, out of identity and back to freedom, or back to source, or to source, or wipe away all the faults. So, this identification is certainly the problem, but holding a certain practice associated with belief in a substantial self that needs to be freed has to be surrendered as well. Going on, ever since the disciples came to know that Maharaj was seriously ill, a pall of gloom descended on the occupants of the loft room. They came to know that Maharaj was suffering from cancer of the throat, a disease Bhagwan Ramakrishna Paramahansa also suffered from in his last days, throat cancer. And, you know, fifth ray, it's, I'm sure Paramahansa, you know, Ramakrishna was not a smoker, but also had throat cancer. I wouldn't be a bit surprised if this is just like the final karmic outpouring of their incarnative cycles, the cycles of incarnation in past lives, that, you know, comes out in terms of the fifth ray, because once one's finished with fifth ray or fifth dimension, one's pretty much home free. And these guys presumably were already home free in this, in that last incarnation. Anyway, Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi similarly suffered from cancer of the left arm, that's associated with heart chakra, sarcoma. Finding the this is very interesting actually. So Ramakrishna was a much earlier teacher, a somewhat earlier teacher, had throat cancer. He was possibly a teacher who was leading with wisdom. I wouldn't say he's imbalanced wisdom over love, but he's leading with wisdom. And so love-based wisdom was the leading edge of his service, let's say, his work, his dharma. Meanwhile, wisdom-based love, or enlightened, obviously, wisdom-based love was the leading edge of Ramana Maharshi's work, or seva, or karma, or, you know, darshan, or, you know, gift in that lifetime. And so it may well be that the leading edge, whether it's love or wisdom, green ray, blue ray, fourth ray, fifth ray, associates with the zone in which the final, in which the basis for leaving the body occurs. The basis of leaving the incarnation may well occur in the leading edge or the front point of that particular teacher's seva, dharma, karma, offering in that lifetime. So Ramana Maharshi leads with love. Leading doesn't mean imbalanced again. Leading with love, perhaps, ends up with the left arm, right? Relates to the throat, relates to, obviously, heart chakra. Ramakrishna and Nisargadatta leading with wisdom, perhaps, both ended up with throat cancer. Now, throat cancer, is that a sign of distortion? Or is that simply the point, you know, the zone in which the final terminus, the termination of the body, departure, the proximate cause of departure from the body, the proximate cause of departure from the body, the basis of making the body unviable, which it must be. Well, everybody has to leave. You have to leave of something. Even those who die in their sleep will, you know, be found to have died of something, or some doctor will have something that they can put on the death as a cause of death, like stroke or heart attack, peacefully in their sleep, let's say. But like, or throat cancer, or left arm cancer, like Ramana Maharshi. It may well be not unusual or common or normative even, not always, but common, that the leading edge of the guru's final life, or, you know, lifetime dharma, seva, work in the world, is the site that is the proximate cause of the body's unviability. Something like that. Finding the devotees moody and with no cheer on their faces, he told them in his jocular way, Quote, "There's no difference at all between life and death. Were you not dead before you were born?" Right. Of course. "Were you not dead before you were born? Or were you not alive before you were born?" Of course. He goes on, "What is darkness other than the absence of light? What is death other than the absence of life?" Meanwhile, he's saying, you know, you were dead before you were born, but your dead was not dead. You're dead and you're alive. There's no difference at all between life and death. Now, that seems to contradict what is death other than absence of life. I think he's really saying there cannot be absence of life. And you can say you were dead before you were born, but you really can't say you're alive now and won't be after. To go on, going on, "To relieve them of the fear," I don't think it was fear, he said, quote, "The fear of death is actually a product of the desire to live, the desire to perpetuate one's identity with the elusive entity of I. Those who know reality also will know the falsity of life and death." That's not a quote, the second part. So, he said, "The fear of death is actually a product of desire to live, the desire to perpetuate identity with this entity, the identity with I." Actually, I mean, the fear of death as a product of desire is the desire to continue incarnation indefinitely, a fear of the unknown, and clearly identification with the body as the basis of life. The physical body is not the basis of life. So like in so many near-death experiences or OBE or experiences of people out of the body, people who, quote, died, don't know they're dead, but they're not dead. You're dead and you're still alive. Got it? And so you have died, you're not in your physical body, but you're still alive. Life goes on. Life is eternal. Yeah, because life is ultimately the source of light. And it's only light that flickers. But the source of life doesn't flicker. It's changeless. It's infinite power, intelligent infinity. That's called omnipotence. Omnipotence. Potence everywhere prior to light. And generational to light, generative of light. So, coming to know that Maharaj's life might end at any time, the disciples, not all but a few, who were permitted in the loft room, were keen to tape Maharaj's last words, as they were very precious. The irrevocability of death lent its sinister image. Another flowery writer. The irrevocability of death lent it a sinister image. As Sri Balsakar puts it in his own inimitable language, quote, everybody loves this inimitable way, "Dark and dismal clouds overhung the horizon, and there was the distant rumbling of the thunder and lightning. We knew the storm was coming, the inexorable finality, the relentless leveler who holds nothing as sacrosanct. The disciples were in a very unenviable position. They knew that their beloved master's vitals had been consumed by cancer and that the frail body cannot hold out any longer. But they did not want to show their fear to Maharaj for the reason that he would be hurt to find that his teachings were wasted on them." Maybe. Some. "They had heard Maharaj say that, quote, death was an ecstasy, and to treat it as only the body that is subject to birth and death and not imperishable Atma." And so you see, many, many disciples remain, you know, somewhat crude and unknowing. It's almost like some disciples are actually afraid of attainment. It's very odd. It's like some children are afraid to grow up, or some souls are afraid to leave childhood. Maybe because then there's greater responsibility. But there's something kind of rosy, wistful, perhaps, in that mind that wishes to stay in childhood, not grow up. Not learn, in this case, not get it. His teaching is fantastic. Some don't want to get it, or those that don't get it, maybe they don't want to get it. So this shit of inexorable finality, relentless leveler who holds nothing as sacrosanct. Oh, rage, rage against the dying of the light. What kind of silliness is this? There is a finality The body's finished. This body's finished. The vehicle's finished. The incarnation's finished. The entity goes on in another body in another dimension. They can come here. They can interface with us. But clearly, we lose the physical proximity, the physical body of our beloved. Sure. But this, you know, death as the relentless leveler who holds nothing as sacrosanct. Why can you even write this shit? You know? I mean, really? Why say such stuff? It's not even true. Death is not a leveler, but we all die, or the body dies. So it's very strange, and he's like teaching them all the time, and they don't want to get it, some of them. Even Sri Balsakar, who was a teacher himself, maybe he, you know, was just being poetic here, but it's very strange. And so, but it's not, death is not, in my humble opinion, a relentless leveler who holds nothing as sacrosanct. It's all sacrosanct. Life is eternal. We're not talking about life. We're talking about incarnation. The incarnation is over, and you continue. And the I that speaks is not the body, is not the mind, is not even Atman, actually. It's the one that made the whole... It's ultimately at one with the one that made light. You know? A drop of the ocean is water. Or a drop of water in the ocean is the ocean. The nature of the ocean is the nature of the drop. And so, anyway, it's odd, some of this. So though the disciples had assimilated the teachings and were fully aware of the prospects of his passing away, intellectually they accepted it, but emotionally found it very difficult. I think emotionally they don't want to accept it, that's all. The last talks, though brief, were full of light and wisdom, and like the candle which burns bright before it burns out, they were Upanishadic in nature. Mm. As Sri Balsakar, a disciple, translator, and later teacher in his own right, said, it was a great beyond speaking and not a frail old man in the clutches of death. Yes, of course, it was coming from source. Let me see time here. I got to pull this together. I'll read a little more. Sri Mularpatan told me that he was constantly attending a Maharaj during his last days and found to his sorrow that Maharaj was not able to talk to his disciples with his old zest. As he found that talking drained his energy, he had to make a humble request to Maharaj to talk for half an hour and not more, as it exhausted him physically so much that he was unable to sit up thereafter. The body was very weak. He said that the visitors also responded in an intelligent way in view of the extremely weak condition of Maharaj, finding their discomfiture, tried to encourage them by saying, get your difficulties cleared up. There is so little time left now. He knew he was about to leave. So they kept coming to him saying, gimme, gimme, you know, teach me, more, more, more. If they really loved him, they should have just sat him silently and sent him love light. And just sat there in the room. That's it. Don't take more talking. I must mention here of the sorrow of the poor crowd of beedi buyers. They found that Maharaj was critically ill, and they could not gain entry into his apartment even to stand from a distance and have their last darshan. In their innocent way, from rumors afloat outside the house, they thought that Maharaj was dying and will not be seen any more by them. They could not reconcile themselves to the finality of death and the impermanence of the body. They grew to love Maharaj by their association with him for many, many days in the morning over the purchase of bidis and the half-hour talk by Maharaj. Emotionally, they found themselves unable to contain their feelings of separation from Maharaj. One day, Maharaj was informed that his old customers, most of them poor old people of the locality, were anxious to have a glimpse of him, and that they were not allowed inside by the people guarding the entrance, restricting the admission, not to disturb Maharaj, who needed a lot of rest, and to prevent him from having an emotional outburst. So people just kept coming, like, please, please talk to us. On seeing his dear and poor customers, Maharaj, with his instinctive compassion, allowed them to climb up to the loft room in small batches to have a glimpse of him, and then go down. Maharaj consoled them, saying that he was not going away anywhere, and he'll be with them, and he'll be soon selling them bidis. Maharaj's love for them became a legend, and they were the first callers on Maharaj. I think that's where I'm going to end it today. There's a little bit more. Let me just see. There's a little bit more, but I think it's okay to end it here because it's a large field of teaching and meaning and value. This section called Last Days, which is succeeded by the next section called The Last Moments, which is very short. So rather than push through this section, I'll stop in the middle of this section, The Last Days, pick it up next time, and then conclude with The Last Moments, very short, three little paragraphs next time, and some comments on, you know, death of the beloved and the fact that disciples in some ways don't want to get it, or to some degree we don't want to make peace emotionally, which is normal, even if we know better. So, but everyone passes away and everybody has to, everybody needs proximate cause of death, no matter how high the soul, right? So, Ramana Maharshi has sarcoma in the left arm relating to heart chakra, I'd say. Ramakrishna and Nisargadatta pass away by throat cancer. Nityananda, on the other hand, his body was certainly frail and weak and not well, but I don't know if there was any cause of death. He just basically announced it and took three breaths, you know, like Babe Ruth. You know, Babe Ruth steps up to bat, so the story goes, maybe it's true, I don't know, points to right field or left field and says, I'm going to put the ball up there. And at some point, the pitch comes in and he hits the ball where he pointed, he'd be hitting it. And so Nityananda was like that. He just said, I'm leaving next Tuesday, or, you know, soon, get yourself ready, I'm leaving soon. And then on the day, when the day of the departure that he promised, he did the final talks and preparations, took a few breaths, and that was it. Out he went. So that's, you know, the summit of capacity to leave the body, I'd say. It's called in advance, and the mind is so much, you know, there's no, that's the mind of Atman, or the mind of Paramatman. And the mind of Atman, the conscious mind, is now the mind of Atman or Paramatman, for that one, I'd say. And nearly everybody needs a proximate cause of death, though, or has the view. Like all these gurus are a different level, it seems to me, than Nityananda. But everybody needs, you know, some kind. Everybody needs a proximate cause of death. And it's just a matter of time. And everybody should understand that. It's always a matter of time before we go, our loved ones go. That's the way of third density. And life is eternal. And life is greater than incarnation. So, anyway, that's all for today. So I hope that's helpful. And he's a great teacher and great being. So I hope this was useful to you. Take good care of yourself. See you next time, and good night.